How were plants classified before Linnaeus, the father of modern taxonomy, came into the picture? They were simply classified as either harmful or poisonous and shouldn't be eaten, or whether they were useful and could be used for food, spices, medicinal purposes, construction, transportation, and communication. Seems practical, right? Well, it's a bit subjective, and there are 391,000 plant species that have been identified so far. It wouldn't be so bad if you were dealing with 100 species. I'm Dr. DeBusk, and in this video, you will learn how plants are classified. Before you begin to classify plants, it is important to understand why they are classified. Plants are classified for identification and cataloging purposes, as well as to overcome language barriers. When plants are scientifically classified and named, the plant retains that same name all over the world, unlike common names that can be very different within the same country or even the same state. Do you recognize the plant on the page? Its scientific name is Transcantia zebrina, but its common name, just in the U.S., can be wandering Jew or inch plant. Make up your mind. Funny enough, Transcantia zebrina is formerly known as Zebrina pendula. So even the scientific names can get reclassified. By classifying plants, we can better understand their origins and help uncover the relationship among plants, which is useful information when growing different types of plants together for the benefit of each. Today, scientists use similarities among plants to break them down into 8 groups. The first is the kind of stem. Stems can be broken down into 2 basic categories, woody or non-woody, herbaceous. The woody plants include shrubs, trees, and some vines, produces wood and has buds which survive above ground level during the winter months. The non-woody or herbaceous plant has soft non-woody stems. Non-woody or herbaceous plants typically include turf grasses, herbs, ground covers, and flowering plants. The overall size of the plant at maturity is commonly used to classify and name plants. Plants may be dwarf, which exhibit shortened internodes, or they may be standard size with normal internode lengths. In the photos at the bottom left, you can see the difference in internode length between standard and dwarf maize. Dwarf plants are also common in the nursery and landscape industry. You may be familiar with the dwarf yaupon holly, but may not have known that it comes in a standard version, which is much larger. The stem growth form is based on how the stem stands in relation to the ground. For example, an erect stem is vertical with respect to gravity, whereas a creeping habit stem grows horizontal with respect to gravity. A plant that grows along the ground and then climbs when it comes in contact with an obstacle has a climbing habit, like an ivy plant. These terms are often used in weed identification guides. The characteristic of the fruit is another means of classifying plants. For example, fruits are classified as fleshy if they are soft and succulent, such as a peach, or dry if they are hard and have a low water content, such as a walnut. Fleshy fruits can be further classified as a berry, akene, drupe, pome, papo, and others. Dry fruits are often classified as either dehiscent, splits open, such as legumes like peanuts, or indehiscent, doesn't split open, like a caryopsis or wheat grain. Plants can be designated as annuals, biennials, or perennials. Annuals are plants that germinated from seed, grow to full maturity, flower, and produce seeds in one growing season. In other words, these plants go from seed to seed in one season. For example, spinach, lettuce, and petunias. To extend the flowering period for annuals, a process known as deadheading is commonly used. Deadheading refers to removing dead or dying flowers from annuals so the plant continues to live and bloom longer. To keep basil in a more tasty vegetative state, I'll remove the flowers as they come up. Biennials are plants that complete their life cycle in 2 growing seasons, such as carrots, parsley, and celery. Vegetable biennials are harvested like annuals because we eat the stored organ. If you leave carrots in the ground for 2 years, the carrots will be woody and disgusting. Biennial plants require a vernalization period in order to flower. Vernalization refers to using cold treatment to induce flowering. Have you ever grown parsley for feeding butterfly larvae? The first season, it looks like normal parsley, but the next year, the leaves totally change shape and it flowers. Perennials are plants that may be herbaceous or woody and live for more than two growing seasons. There are three types of perennials. With herbaceous perennials, the tops die and the roots live throughout the winter months. When I lived in Virginia, one of my favorite herbaceous perennials was Autumn Joy sedum, since the seed heads on the dead stems provided food for birds and it gave the landscape some texture. At the end of winter, the stems easily pulled out, making way for emerging leaves. With deciduous perennials, the root systems and stems live through the winter months. When or if a plant loses its leaves is a characteristic commonly used to classify and name plants. Deciduous plants lose their leaves during a portion of the year, usually the winter months. This dogwood tree is covered with ice, showing the buds that will open once spring comes. With evergreen perennials, the root system, stems, and leaves live throughout the winter months. This juniper stays green even with a heavy layer of snow. Evergreen plants hold their leaves all year. How plants handle temperature is also used to classify and name plants. Tender plants, such as tomatoes and peppers, cannot tolerate cool weather. That's why they are planted after the last frost in vegetable gardens. Hardy plants, such as broccoli and chrysanthemums, are less sensitive to temperature extremes than tender plants. Broccoli, carrots, and cabbage are cool season vegetables. The number of cotyledons, seed leaves, and the type of leaf venation are commonly used to classify and name plants. Dicot plants are characterized by two cotyledons and have reticulate leaf venation. Monocot plants are characterized by one cotyledon and have parallel leaf venation. There are other characteristics of monocots and dicots that will be covered in the next video. Scientific classification uses the morphology of plants, the plant's form and structure, as a means of classification and names plants based on the International Code of Botanical Nomenclature. In 1753, Linnaeus published the Species Plantarum, a two-volume work, which presented the binomial nomenclature system for plant classification that is commonly used today. An example of the binomial nomenclature system, a two-name system, is Zea Maize L. Silver Sweet. In this example, the first word is the genus, Zea, followed by the species, Maize, Authority, L, in this case Linnaeus, and cultivar, Silver Sweet. Under the binomial nomenclature system, the genus and species are either underlined or italicized, with the first letter in the genus capitalized and the species all lowercase. Many binomials also indicate an authority, which is the person involved in the discovery, description, and naming of the plant. You can see that Silver Sweet is a white sweet corn cultivar. The following is the botanical classification system commonly used for horticultural plants. We will follow an example with a red delicious apple plant. Its classification will be highlighted in purple, but I will also focus on the other important plant taxa. We start with plants in kingdom Plantae. The plant kingdom can be lumped into four different divisions that distinguish how a plant reproduces and stores fluids. In reality, each ally has its own division name, but they share many of the same characteristics. In the bryophyta division, we have mosses and their allies, such as liverworts and hornworts. They are non-vascular plants. Non-vascular plants are plants that are unable to circulate fluid from their stems and leaves. Instead, these types of plants absorb water from the environment around them. Bryophyte plants are prevalent on the ground and are known to grow on rocks and even other plants. These plants reproduce by using spores and never grow flowers. The pteridophyta division includes ferns and related species. Physically, they resemble the appearance of plants in the bryophyte division. They also reproduce from spores instead of seeds. Pteridophyta plants, however, have a vascular system which allows them to transport fluid using the stem and leaves. Coniferophyta are vascular plants that reproduce from seed rather than spores. They are commonly referred to as gymnosperms, which means naked seed. Seeds in coniferophyta plants usually do not have any fruit or flowers surrounding them. Coniferophyta plants usually take the form of trees or shrubs that contain cones and needle-shaped leaves and never grow flowers. Conifera phytoplants include pines, firs, spruces, cedars, junipers, and yews. Allies of the conifera phyta include ginkgo, cycads, and gonita phytoplants. Over 230,000 species of plants belong to the magnolia phyta division and are commonly known as flowering plants or angiosperms. These are vascular plants that reproduce using seeds. Unlike the conifera phyta, the seeds are enclosed within the plant's ovary, part of the plant that specializes in seed production. Species in the magnolia phyta division include all agricultural crops, all vegetables, cereal grains, and other grasses, all garden flowers, and most horticultural plants, all the common broadleaf shrubs and trees, and the majority of weeds. This is what apple trees are in. If we go down further, we come to class. For angiosperms, we commonly make the divide between dicots or magnolioopsida or liliopsida or monocots. Dicots include most garden plants, shrubs, and trees, and broadleafed flowering plants. Monocots include grasses, palms, orchids, irises, lilies, and many others. Apple trees are dicots. After class, subclass order and family follow. In family, the plants are grouped based on natural plant relationships using structural and cultural similarities. For apple trees, subclass order and family is Rosaceae, Rosales, and Rosaceae. Notice the endings of each of these. We have Idae for subclass, Ales for order, and Aceae for family. These endings are consistent with the naming of plants. Moving into the minor taxa, the genus is based on morphology and genetic, biochemical, and molecular relationships. In the case of apple, it is Malus. Species or specific epithets are plants that are grouped with even greater refinements than the genus, but are still grouped based on morphology and genetic, biochemical, and molecular relationships. The species name for apple is Domestica. If you were going to tell someone the species name of an apple, you would say both the genus and species, or Malus Domestica. Horticulturalists are generally interested in the botanical variety, form, biotype, and clone. When any of these are intentionally cultivated, they are referred to as a cultivar, cultivated variety, for example, a red, delicious apple. The term cultivar has replaced the older term variety to avoid confusion with the taxonomic term. In a taxonomic sense, a variety means a botanical variety. The cultivar is sometimes written with single quote marks. A cultivar is a group of plants within a cultivated species that is distinguishable by a character or group of characters and that maintains its identity when propagated either sexually or asexually. Cultivars can be distinguished by the following characteristics: the size, shape, and number of different floral parts, as shown in these cultivars of crepe myrtle; the fruit flesh types, color, size, and shape, as shown in these cultivars of peach; and the vegetative parts, such as the buds, bark color, size, and hardiness, as shown in these two cultivars of Chinese elm. When a breeder puts a lot of time and effort into establishing a cultivar, the grower must establish ownership to prevent patent infringements. Buyers pay a premium for a patented cultivar since the breeder gets royalties for 20 years. Patent holders may also employ a scout to buy plants at various outlets and run analyses of these plants to determine whether the plants are being used legally. There are a few other minor plant categories that you should be familiar with since you may see these designations as part of the species name. The subspecies designation is for a group deviating more from the species norm than the variety and abbreviated as SUBSP period or SSP period. One example from the succulent world is Crassula pubescens subspecies Rattrai and Crassula pubescens subspecies radicans. The former possesses fuzzy leaves, while the latter does not. If you look at the name for a typical cabbage plant, it is Brassica oleracea, variety capitata, formis alba. Brassica oleracea, a common wild mustard plant, was bred and selected for different parts, which we now grow as different vegetables, such as broccoli and cauliflower for flower buds, cabbage for its terminal bud, and kale for leaves. Weird, huh? Okay, back to cabbage. In order to name the cabbage, the taxonomy needs to go a little further. Variety is the botanical nomenclature division consisting of a natural occurring variation of a plant within a species, below this level of subspecies, and is indicated by the abbreviation VAR period in the scientific name. In botany, capitata means forming a dense head. Form slash race designates a group with a noticeable morphological deviation, is below variety, and is indicated by the abbreviation F period. Alba means white, since when you cut one open, it is white. The form designation for red cabbage is rubra, meaning what? You guessed it, it means red. There are many other minor plant categories out there to designate differences. In conclusion, the classification of plants has come a long way from the times of our ancient ancestors, who only had two main categories for classifying plants, namely as harmful or useful. Today, scientists group plants in 8 ways based on plant similarities for their classification. That botanical classification breaks plants down into distinct categories. Cultivar identification is important, especially when communicating with others.